Good morning, students, and welcome back to another class of English literature. In today's video, we are going to continue with the prose Chief Seattle speech. In our previous video, we learned about Seattle, who was a leader of the Squamish tribe in the Washington Territory in the 19th century. This piece of prose is a part of his long and moving speech which he delivered in 1854 at Washington. And the speech has been widely cited as a powerful bittersweet plea for respect of Native Americans' land rights and environmental values. Today we will delve into the depth of the lesson. This piece of prose is actually a speech delivered by Seattle in 1854 at Washington, which contains arguments in favor of ecological responsibility and respect of Native Americans' land rights. Seattle hopes that their good father in Washington, that is the US president, would protect the people of the Squamish tribe, and his brave warriors would prove to be a great wall of strength. Seattle, who belonged to this tribe, delivered the speech at Washington, where he pursued the path of accommodation to white settlers in the US state of Washington. He spoke about the ecological responsibility and respect of Native Americans' land rights. He recollects the hostilities which existed between the white and the red Indians, or the Native Americans. Now, the Native Americans are also referred to as the Red Indians because of their dark skin color. Seattle feels that the old tribal people will never like to resume the old hostilities, and he hopes that the good father in Washington would protect them. Seattle realizes that the whites and the natives are two distinct races. There is little common in them. In the speech, he makes a clear reference to the proposition, which is a land treaty which he received from the white man. And Seattle hopes that his people will react favorably to the proposition and accept it. But Seattle places a condition before taking up a decision. He wanted his people to have the freedom to visit the tombs of their ancestors, friends, and children at any point of time. Seattle opines that the deserted streets at night will be thronged with the returning hosts that once filled the land and still love this beautiful land. What he means to say here is the dead ancestors, they still love, the soul of the dead ancestors still love the beautiful land where they lived. Hostilities between the two races. Seattle recollects the time when the white man began to push their forefathers westward. There were hostilities between them, and Seattle wishes that those hostilities may never return. The young people, they would like to take the revenge, but the old tribal people are wise and would never like to resume the hostilities towards the whites. He hopes that their good father in Washington would prove to be a great wall of strength against their ancient enemies who frightened their women, children, and the old men. And then in reality, the US president, that is the good father, would be their father, and the natives would be his children. Moving on, the white man and the tribal people. Seattle feels skeptical about one thing. He feels that the God of the white people loves only his own children, that is the white Americans, and hates the Native Americans. Therefore, white Americans' God cannot be the God of the natives because he has abandoned his red children. Then Seattle says that their own God, the Great Spirit, also seems to have abandoned them. Seattle complains that the God of the white people does not love the Native Americans and therefore does not protect them. The natives are like orphans who can look nowhere for help. It is in this context that Seattle remarks that white Americans and Native Americans are two distinct races with separate origins and separate destinies. There is little common in them. The religion of the white man. Seattle then says that the white man's religion was written upon tablets of stone with iron fingers of their god so that they could not forget. Now, what do you mean by iron fingers? It is a biblical phrase which means fingers of God. It refers to the words written onto stone tablets that later were brought down from Mount Sinai by Moses. The tablets were also known as the Ten Commandments. Now, the red man could never comprehend or remember these Ten Commandments. For the Native Americans, religion means the traditions of their ancestors. It constitutes the dreams of their old men and is written in the hearts of their people. He further remarks that their dead cease to love them. That is, the souls of the dead ancestors of the white Americans do not love them after their death. They even do not have any feeling for the land, their native lands. But on the other hand, the souls of the dead ancestors of the Native Americans never forget their beautiful world that gave them being. Seattle further says that the red man has always fled the approach of the white Americans. But the white man's proposition seems fair, and he will feel, or rather decide, whether his people will accept it. Seattle also has a hope that the people will favorably accept the land treaty. He hopes that then they will dwell apart in peace. For a while, Seattle mourns over the graves of his powerful people. But then he philosophizes that tribe follows tribe and nation follows nation, like the waves of the sea. It is the order of nature, and regret is useless. Religion of Native Americans. According to Seattle, there is a vast difference between the religious beliefs of the white men and red Americans. For the white men, religion was written upon tablets of stone by iron finger of gods so that they do not forget. But for the red men, religion means the tradition of their ancestors, the dreams of their old men, which they were given in silent hours of night by the Great Spirit, and the visions of our sachems. Sachems means leaders. And these visions are written in the hearts of the people. Seattle's decision. Finally, Seattle remarks that they will ponder over the proposition and convey the decision to the white Americans or the US president. But before the decision, he puts a condition again, which is that the natives will be given the freedom to visit the tombs of their ancestors, friends and children at any point of time, because every part of the soil is sacred to the Native Americans. The dead people of his race will love the somber solitudes, lonely nights. Seattle feels that when the last red man shall have perished, these shores will swarm with the invisible dead of his tribe. In all the earth, there is no place dedicated to solitude. At night, the deserted streets will be thronged with the returning hosts that once filled them and still love this beautiful land. Few important lines to be remembered. Yonder sky that has wept tears of compassion upon my people for centuries untold, and which to us appears changeless and eternal, may change. Today is fair, tomorrow it may be overcast with clouds. Now, explanation of these lines. At the very beginning of the speech, Seattle expresses his concern over environmental degradation and its possible impact upon human civilization if we do not take immediate measures. According to Seattle, nature has been a great sympathizer for his native people for a long time now. nature has given them everything they need to live on this earth. He fears that though his condition seems to be eternal and changeless, it may ultimately change. Human civilization may face great trouble in future if we don't respect environmental values. Then Seattle ascertains his reliability by comparing his words to the stars that never change. Therefore, he will not change his stance in response to the government's proposal of a land treaty with the natives. The white chief, that is the governor, had arrived with the proposal and the message of friendship from the big chief, that is the US president. Seattle says that it is kind of them to offer the natives their goodwill and friendship because he knows that the government does not require the friendship of the natives. Seattle speaks of the deplorable condition of his people. He remembers that they had once filled the entire country, but now there are only few people left in their tribes. They are on the verge of an extinction. So actually, they do not need the vast land anymore. And for this doom of the Red Indians, Seattle accuses the white people's act of forcing their way into the native lands. The white men are superior, have no respect for the tribal people's land rights and cultural values. Seattle also blames the reckless manners of the young people of his own tribe. According to him, the youth is also responsible for this deplorable state. Seattle says the president has offered to protect the native women, children, and the old men from the attacks of their old outside enemies like the Haidas and the Tsimsheans if they agree to sign the land treaty. In that case, the president would be their protector and their father. But Seattle doubts if this will ever happen. According to Seattle, there is so many cultural differences between the whites and the natives. Both the tribes looks unlikely. After all, they are two distinct races with separate origins and separate destinies. The white people received all the love and care of the God, and the tribal people have been deprived of the love, guidance, and protection of God, which leads to their meager existence. The native red people of America lives closer to nature than the white people. They love the beautiful aspects of nature and understand the importance of maintaining it. To the tribal people, the ashes of their ancestors are sacred and they visit their resting ground to show their respect for those. But Seattle complains that the white people have no feelings for their ancestors because they never return to visit the graveyards. Again, the white people don't seem to love this world anymore after their death. So they never visit the people and places again. But the natives never forget this beautiful world that gave them being and continue to visit their loved ones even after their death to guide, console, and comfort them. Seattle says that the white people's religion was written upon stones, that is, he refers to the Ten Commandments. But the religion for the natives was the tradition of their ancestors, the dreams of their old men. The chief prepares his people for their impending doom by saying that no one will be spared from the hands of time, death, and decay. Death is a common destiny that the white men too cannot defy. Anyway, Seattle says that he may still agree to the government's proposal, but the natives should be allowed to visit the resting grounds of their ancestors at any point of time. Thank you, children. Hope you are clear with the summary and the important lines of the prose. We will continue with our next video, wherein I will explain few more important lines from the lesson. Have a wonderful day ahead, children.